Montreal today at around noon.
Yeah.
And has come in on the limousine to give his first talk, and for us to welcome him as Regent's lecturer at CNMAT for the next 2 weeks, in which he has insisted on having a very, very busy engagement with all kinds of different entities on campus and courses. And so we're super grateful that you're here. Jean-François, I invited you first in 2004, right?
Yeah.
That's what you figured out.
Yeah.
I was thinking it was earlier.
I thought it was 2001, but...
Yeah, and he came and did an extraordinary performance, and it was sort of already, you had already peaked in one way, like you were already visible in the work that you were doing,
mm.
which is now, you know, continuing.
Yeah.
And but I believe it was really in the 90s that you formed your identity, or began to be formed,
mm.
out of a very dispersed and very different background and present. So hopefully you're going to tell us a little bit about that. And there's a number of very connected concert events, and the most important, I think, is this Sunday at the BAM PFA at 7 o'clock, did they say, or 7?
Yeah, start
time is 7 p.m. In that main area at the entrance to the BAM PFA Museum, where Jean-François is part of the Full Moon series of Sarah Cahill. And I think you're basically doing a whole solo show.
Yeah, I'm going to do two sets, about 1 hour each, 2 hours.
And then we will be back at least on March 17th for some event. There was another tentative concert, and we're still working the details out if that's going to happen or not. And then at the same time, there's going to be the issue of our ongoing workshop, which might also lead to another public event. But those things are still floating until we get our feet on the ground around Berkeley. So I welcome, we all welcome you. Thank you for coming.
Thank
you for being here.
I don't know if I'm going to show, if you have any questions. It's difficult to talk in a very small amount of time about a lot of different projects and realizations. So if you have questions that might lead to something else that I didn't think about talking about. Basically, I started music at 25. Before that, I was a civil engineer working on asphalt recycling with a company in Montreal. And I stopped at 24 because I didn't find myself happy with this job. I earned money, but it was not enough for my soul, I guess. And I think 1 year to decide if I'm going to music or not. When I was 19, I've been to Africa with a Canadian exchange between Zaire and Canada. And there I discovered music, percussion mainly, and then singing in a very, very, very natural way. I remember meeting someone on the street and just starting to talk, and then I was playing with him. That's mm-hmm. the next thing that I know. And I was very different from my background in Montreal, where you need to be able to read a sheet in order to make music. Otherwise, you can't enter to the game. So it kept me out of the music for 25 years. And I was remembering at that time, seeing myself as 60 with the same ideas. When I came back at 19 in Montreal, I was, let's take music lesson because you like music since you're born. But my family was not in music, was in sport. So I didn't have the chance to make music or to learn music or be in touch with music. And then I see myself at 60, still with the same ideas of, might like to take music lesson. And the image shot me in a deep way where I considered to stop civil engineer and just take my chance on music. So basically, I started 25 playing classical guitar. And I give myself 5 years till 30. If I can earn money with my music, then I can continue. Otherwise, I go back to civil engineer or construction, which is the other thing. So my parents are a self-house building, so I learned building house since I'm born. So it was basically each year and a half building a house, sell it, build another one. So This is probably why I build a musical instrument, because I have the skill of building things from raw material. So I had that in my background as a security. If it didn't work in music, then I can go back on construction or civil engineer. But I never had to do, still living with music since 1998. And basically, probably because of my background as a researcher in civil engineer and also as a house builder, and my music is really rooted to physicality, sound matters, materiality. This is something that's very important for me, and this is something that I found in all of my musical projects. I'm gonna let you hear one small piece called Electro Prana. It's a recording that I made in 1998, where Montreal was stuck in the big ice storm for about a month without electricity, minus 25. So no lights in the city, no electricity. Very deep winter wind, and I made a piece. The piece is Prana, which is ensemble and tape, and at the end I just put the tape part out to make the small electroacoustic pieces. So I maybe listen to that, and then we may start discussion.
No sound?
No sound.
Maybe it's trying to play out of the video cable?
Yeah. Yeah, let's go to your.
It works still before we made it.
Oh, there it is.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's right. Are you going to put that back in?
It's all made piece that is made with a quite cheap microphone, stereo microphone, 8865 that I had by at that time. And I had that to make that was my first mixed pieces for ensemble and tape or electronics. And yeah, when the storm happened in Montreal, it was right like about 3 weeks before I had to give the material to the ensemble. And I was stuck in the university with nobody inside and nobody outside either. So I found very interesting, there was a lot of winds for several days, and I just, it's a 7-floor building, and like for the low pitches, I just open all the windows on the stairways, tape all the doors except one, and then just play with the doors, but this band at the very low pitches, do the same with the windows, and just trying to be in contact with the wind to feel when it's time to record. And it was very mystical at some point to try to find a way to be in contact with something that's a bit bigger than me. But then I had a lot of fun to do this, those recording. I just thought that there's no need to transform or add something else, and just keep it like this. And can make you listen a little bit of the piece with the ensemble and show you the looks a bit small. So it's a string quartet, and it's 9 instruments, string quartet with percussion and 5 wind instrument. And it looks, it's a bit graphical because I tried to, since the beginning when I have to write for a musician or for a traditional instrument, I tried to first, I run the instrument, I play by myself, find the kind of sounds that I like and that I want to put in music. And basically it happens many times, it's not using normal technique. Also because I don't have the background as a cellist or as a saxophonist, so I play what I can play. And I found that the graphical score is a very nice tools between very nice tools to explain my ideas, musical ideas, or my sound environment to the musician that has to play the sounds. I remember that score when I gave to the conductor the first time, there was text everywhere, and she just told me, like, no, go back. I can do work with this score, it's too much stuff. And I'm going to show you another score where I am now, in between having a lot of text and more drawing. So I just let you listen a little bit of the piece, so you have an idea of that in the beginning, maybe. Quite strange that iTunes don't want to.
I just played it in QuickTime.
Yeah, that's a good idea.
Thank you.
basically what I've done, I really like in my works to have limitation, which helped me to push myself further with the ideas. In that context, my all the wind that I recorded was around G, I don't know English, but Do, C, one. So it's all around this and Fa, so a triton. And I used the wind as the one that play more around the pitches, and the instrument just play C and Fa, the triton, in all different kind of ways and with different kind of techniques to have different kind of sounds, texture. So that was it for this pieces. I want to let you hear another one that is called Impression. I'll let you hear first, and I'm going to ask you after, is it written for what? Chair? No.
Prepare trombone.
Trumpet, trombone.
Prepare saxophone.
Saxophone.
Is it the regular instrument or no?
It's traditional instrument. It's a cello.
Oh.
I'll show you the.
It sounds as if it was blown, but it's not.
Yeah, give me a second. So it's, let's see, Vio somewhere. It's not that big. Basically, the pieces start after an intermission, and the instrument is fixed on the scratching board with the G string and the staff, and I just enter the room, say nothing, and just take the cello. So that I don't do it anymore because it's just a scratch, a bit of the wood of the head of the instrument. But if we go a bit further, you can see. So normally I use only one key of the instrument that I can replace and put mine. And that's the friction with the key and the scratching board that made the low pitches, the high pitches, and the angle of the keys with the pressure. And when I push the high pitches, that's how I can make melody. So basically, it's you find all the parameters that a musician have to deal with, like the pressure, the velocity, the intensity. It's all the same everywhere. Which each instrument. And I try to find context where musicians have to work with what they hear, with what how they feel with the body, not only like using their skill and just reproduce. Like the mechanic is there and work by itself, and they are not implicated in the music and the sounds. And so that is something that I try to find. Of course, when I play my instrument, it's implicated. In it, but when I write for a traditional instrument, I always try to find an area where, if they are not there, the music is not possible to appear. You cannot just go with your techniques and just play the piece because you have the scale and you can read fast. And it implies new techniques or new way of playing instrument, even if it's a traditional instrument. And there's always, not always, but often a visual aspect of my works that I try. I remember the teacher I had was Marcel Deschenes. She's an electroacoustic composer, and we never really talk about what is on the score, but about the title, the lighting, where is the musician, how the musician, which kind of instrument, why those instruments, and a lot of aspect around the music instead of just the music that's written in the paper. And so that's probably why when it's possible, I always think where to put the musician, how we deal with the lights, what are we created there. Like for that piece, it's quite clear.
Is it every time a little bit different, of course, when you performed it, or you don't perform it anymore, you said?
It depends who is performing it, and of course it's always different.
Yeah.
It's different. It's always the same path.
Mm.
Always the dynamic, how it goes, how it grows, the speed, and but of course it's a key scratching the board. So and I don't practice that so as a cellist practice cello.
Mm.
So I have control, but maybe not the refinement that a cellist after 16 years of doing the same gesture can have. But to me, music is not only about like the pitches at this time after this one. There's different layers of what is music and what is the experience as listening to music or being in contact with music. And as a musician, always doing the same thing in the same way, it's not really what I am interested in. And
so
I,
what does the score look like? You, is there a score or do
not
you
for this one?
Yeah.
A few musicians play it. Ensemble Mixus in Belgium that played a piece. Kian in France also. There's video. There's several video of the performance. The rules are written on the text.
Right.
But I didn't want to draw. Most of the piece that I play, I don't draw a score. That's a good question. Let's go with this instrument. So basically, it's called the pipe. I'm gonna find out my instrument have a name that is really related to the shapes or to the instrument. I just because what I see what I see as a pipe, so I don't know what kind of name I can give them. It's the same instrument that is here. I just put it there so you can see physically how it looks. There's different robotized parts. It works with compressor with a latex membrane, and if you blow air inside. And then that goes here. And the hair goes through this long pipe and it's controlled it's filled by a compressor. There's an electronic valve behind that I control with Max MSP and also all the parts there. There's a mute that's just block the tube and make different kind of it's only the same movement but different kind of that like you know a tube when you just block the hand goes to an octave or higher then gives some opportunity. There's this part that's like my fingers on the membrane that changes so the relation between this frequency here and the resonator. That's why you hear like the beating between the two frequencies. There's those that is a tie wrap that bounce on the membrane when the vibration is. So I'm gonna just play it and see how that line. And basically it's just when there's a vibration here, the membrane goes up and down. It's a physical thing. And I just put the membrane, the tie wrap, over its movement and then it bounces by itself because it's flexible. About 30 seconds left. So that was just a demonstration of the instrument that called it's called the pipe. There's a few pieces that I played the concert of either next Wednesday or next Friday, 17. I bring two of them, so I'm gonna have a duo. There's a microphone that came here, so there's a real-time process using different, mostly distortion and pitch shifting. So that will be for my piece, that is called Jonas dans la baleine. And I'm gonna play a piece of Zach Zettel, which is also for the same instrument, but using the Kinect as a controller. So I basically dance in front of the Kinect and that control the two instruments, the gesture, the movement. And you also have some treatment from DSP according to how I move in the space. And I bring it because it's very interesting as a controller. I don't really think often I play my piece with an iPad, controlling all the parameters because I can walk and just be around. But also one reason why they are hanging, they don't touch the ground. Before I had I can show you the first version of this instrument. Are you going to see? No. I had a straight feet before, and the instrument like just on the feet. And I was trying to find a solution to give them another personality, because when there's a feet, it's we're on the same level, there's the connection, it's completely different. Now the fact that they are hanging and all the techniques goes with you, it became a bit more mysterious at some point and more magical, let's say. And also it goes more with all my work in sound installation, where you install the object in the space, where you install the space.
When you began developing this instrument, did you start with the membrane as a form of a mouthpiece, or was there another way?
Yeah, it's a good question. I can show you a piece that is called the floating. If I can see, it's very small on my computer. So here is the score. So it's a balloon pieces. 12 musicians, 25 minutes, playing only balloon. So there's the lexical and all the the sign that explain how to play pieces. I can play you an excerpt. But everything that was written in 1996, and everything's all my work with latex came from this piece. I had a bunch of latex balloon and tried to find many different kind of techniques. To play balloons as a musical instrument. And of course, I have difficulty to put things on the garbage. So I keep a bunch of balloon cut, not cut, and just playing with material. That one time I just put over a tube and just realized, feel the sound. And I just wanted to continue to develop the instrument. A few, because now you hear it without the resonator, but. Sound for a little instrument. Mm-hmm. So it's all. I was able in the beginning to put keys to start to make pitches and melody, but I really decided at one point to just keep it as it is, in the way that. The relation to the instrument, it's not reproducing melody or pitches or sounds, but more a contact with the sounds, with the material, and just how you follow what you hear and how you shape it after musically. And I call also the instrument is called a tuyo. This one is called the pipe because of the shape and the structure, but the name of the instrument is called tuyo, and it's the Spanish version of it. T-U/YO, and it means you and me. and it's like in French, especially in Quebec, a tuyau is a pipe, or like a tube, you say in English, but we say tuyau in French. So when you hear the sounds, it reminds you of a tuyau, a tube, and also for me it's the relation between the instrument and the player, which is all based on the timbral experimentation and how you connect with timbral as a player. So I started with that piece before I arrived to this one, and there was several layer of development. I'm gonna make you listen a little bit of this. Everything starts with that piece that was not one of my maybe the four or fifth piece that I write. This is very a turning point where, I arrived as a classical guitarist. I wanted to be a singer, singing my song. After the first 6 months, I discovered Ligeti and those kind of music, and I just opened my mind. And then after the first year, I just paid someone to have a composition lesson. And from there, I just keep going and try to discover and do my stuff. So just to show you a bit of the trio, that was in the beginning. Record on a boat hull transporter that transports a lot of big materials. It's like big boat container. It was empty because in 1998 I also write a boat symphony for 15 boat two trains on the old port of Montreal. If you want, I can show you a bit of that after. And during the time I was working with the boat, because in Montreal the boat are stuck from December to March on the ice. Then the second week of March they go, and so we have like about 3 months to learn about the horn and the pitches and find ways to make music with them. And so during my research I meet developer or young guys, but was very happy that I was interested to do something on the boat, and because I really do nothing. And that boat particularly stayed in Montreal for about 3.5 years before they shipped to India, where they cut it in pieces because it was too old. So on the recording there's about 17 seconds of reverberation. It's a very huge metal you see the instrument in the beginning was like just on a straight feet and a tube bar in the middle. The room is very huge. Goes in the same dimension on the earth as before. So that was the tube before the trio at that time. I think you saw that in 2004, that version.
Yeah.
And then evolved to this. But still, I continue to play those one. I'm going to play Sunday a piece called Rust with two of them under a chair. That I manipulate, and it's also there's real time process on that piece.
So I have a quick question about the air compressor.
Yeah.
So do you remove the diaphragm that the air compressor comes with, and you replace it with this sort of network of pipes?
I don't. I use the compressor as a poumon.
Lung.
Yeah.
And they just either send that to a reservoir, a tank, or either just on a pipe, on the tube here.
And it keeps those metal containers with a high enough pressure that when you turn the crank, you're just releasing.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I can play with the pressure or with the velocity, with the amount of air.
Mm-hmm.
Both have different effect on the sound timbrel. Normally the pressure changes more the temporal aspect and the amount of air more the volume. They are related to both affect a bit of each other.
Okay. And so you know exactly the air compressor that you rent every single time you go to.
But that what I do normally is I just reduce. I have before like 10 bar of pressure or 125 psi, but I filter that to 75 and less. So in order to always have the same continuous pressure, instead of having 125 and then going to 60 and going back, and
yeah.
It happens sometimes when I play on a place where the compressor is not big enough, then I have to fight always open, close the valve, open while I'm playing, which is not ideal. But
And you just rent them each time you go somewhere new?
Yeah, because it's quite heavy material.
Yeah.
But I'm working now on a piece called Mantra Live, because I have made a mantra in 1997, which is a 25 minutes one-shot recording of a 6 big machine.
Mm-hmm.
And now I want to make a live version of it. And I use air compressor. So I will see if I'm going to tour with the compressor or just make different mantra in different places. And that if I do different mantra, then I will have to be there a bit earlier, like 10 days before, to just find the possibility with the sound possibility of the machine and then create another piece with it.
Right.
Or traveling with my compressor and having always the same kind of response.
Mm-hmm.
I'm going to use a lot of contact microphones and different objects to make it as a real experience. So I'm going to play that piece also probably Sunday. Or Friday, we'll see.
There's a kind of elegant simplicity in all of the instruments that really adds to their kind of, you keep using the word magical or mystique.
Yeah.
And I was wondering, you know, it gives the impression that you just got together one day and that was that, and you had it all engineered. What's the process of engineering, of iterations, of finding the right material for the even the balloon material in order so it doesn't break, and all these, there must be a great deal of hidden history, I'm guessing.
Yeah, at the beginning, of course, the first sparkles that makes me continue to develop the instrument, because there's others experiment that I does that didn't bring that reach the level of the instrument. The first contact is always very simple. But then, to develop the techniques of playing, to find the right ways of fixing things together, and optimize the response, the sound response on the instrument, that takes times and times. And even now, I passed 10 days to work on Rust, the piece that I'm going to play Sunday with the 2-tube. And after 10 days, I was finding new possibility of controlling the sounds. But that is something that will never end. It's you go deeper on the refinement of subtleties that I'm probably the only one that hear it or feel it. But I'm sure the experience is also different for the listener, even if they don't understand, they can put the fingers on the new things that I found. But and also I'm I use a lot of material that came from the industry, and the industry changed. So the instruments changed also. Like the ball that you see in the photos in the beginning, before the membrane was at 40 inches, right? And at one point they decided 36 inches is going to be enough. But for the instrument, it didn't work. 36 inches, I cannot stretch it on the ball anymore. So now I use smaller ball, but even those membranes are 12 inches and they arrive with 11 inches. And then it's not the same sound. But also the materiality of the membrane, it's not, of course you can put any kind of balloon you're gonna find, but yet the richness sounds, I discovered that the pearl membrane are the best. The colors affect the sound too. Yellow and red are quite similar, but then if you go to purple, black, brown, I don't know why, but the membrane is less resistant. It's very, not soft, but it didn't melt, but there's no no tension, there's no reaction with the hair. So I cannot make the same kind of sounds. There's two reasons why now I use the yellow and red. It's first, if you use a lot of colors, like if I put 12 instruments here and I put different colors, it's you arrive on the place where people think it's toys, because it's just it's colors, the balloons, so they don't take it seriously at some point. And also because of the response of as a material, it's not the same. Those are the most efficient, the yellow and the red. That's what I discover with time. But still, now they be about 5 years ago, they decide to make balloons that make no noise when kids play with them. So they changed the way they make the latex, and so yeah, the response is a little different. So I have to deal with it.
You should write them an angry letter.
And also, that I arrived in, I remember I was in Krakow. This part was, I don't know where. They just, everything was on, how do you say it, the Pirunga? The airport. And all parts were like one after the others, but this part was somewhere where I didn't find it. And I said, I go to the shop and buy one. And there are the elbow? Yeah. The elbow is like straight. So it's not really, didn't make the same kind of shape. So I use a cleaner dryer tube, the one that you can stand on. So I paint it white and just attach it here. It looks like almost the same. But yeah, it's, we see them and we think it's always, it's there everywhere, it's the same. But material are not the same anywhere, and I have to deal with it. It's part of my. I use like the straight one. I use Japanese tube because those one the wall is very thick, and they have a water pipe. It's like paper wall, and so then it vibrates differently, and the harmonics are more rich. And so I still everywhere I go in the world, I go to the shop and just walk around and see what they have and see what I can do and make tests on the shop. I remember with a cello in the beginning, going to a wood shop and trying boards. And it's always funny to see people that came and ask you questions. Are you okay? Do you think it's fine? You want to hear a bit of the Boat Symphony? I don't know how much time I have, but
We have time. Maybe just one more question about when I know your work, and I can understand how you interface with the art world in a special way, because very, very little work going on in the art world in my mind has such strong musical sonic quality as yours does. But at the same time, your objects, they cross a kind of liminal line between what is organic and what is physical and simple and in the physical world, with the membrane being like skin or po, like lungs and all of these things. So I can see how you sort of bridge and you gain acceptance in another community that maybe, was that always part of your thinking to be?
Being accepted, no.
But to be able to move in these different communities, to be an artist, basically, is.
Yeah, I didn't.
And by that?
Never think about it. I mean, the first thing for me was doing what I want to do, what sparkle myself, what is just when I see them, I'm excited. And so this is the first main interest when I'm in anatomy and just discover things and just be curious and be fascinated by vibration, because basically this is what it is. And when it's physical, for me it's more easier to understand what's happening. It's more related to the world I live in. For example, like being on a boat with this 17 second of reverb, I was there and I feel the reverb and I was part of the reverb. I would never have this kind of experiences being with my lexicon reverb and you know, in a studio and just push, okay, I want a big room, and a big room, but what is a big room?
A cathedral,
for example. But like the first piece with the wind, like the door at the end is just a toilet door and a microphone inside, and I have all of this acoustic of this toilet. And this is something that I believe when I'm going to be like 70 or 80 years old, I want to have a science that is developed with the contact with real things. And I don't say that it's not good to make electronic music or just work in the studio, but just me with my background, and I'm related to material, and this is what I feel comfortable with. This is where I found things and where I found myself created at some point. And I think there's a link with all kind of art form, because you have that in dance, you have that in theater, you have that in video too. There's always physicality and this kind of aspect that where you can go on the side of the material instead of the other side of conceptual. Of course, both are there. But
well, it seems, that's what I'm saying. It seems to be active whether you design it or not. It seems to work.
Yeah.
From the conceptual point of view, there's all kinds of things to
mm-hmm.
to think about. But there's also the issue of power in sound, in physical objects. And even though sometimes your objects are not making a lot of sound, they immediately communicate that there's power, if so watch out. You know, there's some potential kinetic.
Yeah.
Is that like I would call it danger? That even that this could get dangerous if you're not careful. Is that true?
There's that in some of my pieces. But it's, I remember those instruments. I'm gonna open one just to show you.
It's just kind of a normal pipe. Gonna see how it
can make it turn.
So there's two wall that are black in the bottom, and the air goes inside those wall, and then when you push air inside, and the air, the only place that you escape is like from inside the middle here, and the movement here on the skin make the skin vibrate. And I made a piece where I put those together with a telescopic tube. I remember I wasn't kind of, it was not a church, it was a chapel. And there's only five jewels of them, one at each corner and one in the middle. I'm going to show you after a bit of the sounds, but I try to be as soft as possible, as quiet as possible. And even there, I was sitting, I was like, the presence of the sound is really, really, really deep. And I think it has to do with the fact that it's a physical phenomenon. The presence is not the same than if you put the same sound with the same level on speakers. You don't feel this. To me, sound is material. It's like wood. It's not abstract. It's something physical. There's particle that travel around the space and that you can connect with and feel with your body. And in that way, I agree with you. Physical sounds have an impact that is dangerous at some point because you can be addicted to, not because it's loud, but because it's just, it's difficult, it's different. It's, to me, it's magical. Other question? So I let you hear a bit of the vibes. That's the name of the installation. Okay, I know what I'm going to show you. The instrument first. the book. Okay, where? It's at the end, I think. So, okay, all sound installation. Just to show you the ball. You see the shape now? Compared to what you see on the boat, I have straight feet, and all of that now it became just because physically what I wanted is to have when you put a light inside the bowl and you put everything in the dark, you have the impression that the bowl is floating. So that's why I came with this feet that goes from behind. So when you're in front of the instrument, you don't see the feet. And the other shapes is just to make this going up and going down, because there's a motor here that just make this part going up and down. It's like a finger on a string, where you can change the parameter and frequency and just go to. So that's the those instruments. They are linked together and they have a telescopic tube, and there's a small motor, linear motor behind. So I can make just slide between those two frequencies and so make beating. And yeah, I realize when you have two pitches that are very close on a space, it became very, very present compared if I have just one pitches, like just one tone. You had another one, then it started to beat, the reflection makes a different place on the space, and it became much more organic. And so just to let you hear a bit out sound, memory of shadow. So I use this for a dance piece, but it's not this one, sorry. This one. Three sounds like an organ. Very slow slide, and there's a dancer and it's a duo, dancer and music life. So it's very long descendo between frequency. Also people make a video, and it's funny, it's one of the rare time in my music where I do this piece is 15 minutes, it's just two chords, a major chord sliding to a minor chord, going back to the major chord, stretch on 15 minutes. Yeah.
Was some choreographing on the dancer, or was it just a collaboration between you and her?
It's a series that I started about 9 years ago, where I invite choreographer to make a dance piece on a sound installation of mine, which is completely different than normally we are called to make music on their choreography. And we, of course, we work and I change some stuff in my music. And, but yeah, I just changed, returned the paradigm and asked them to develop something according to one of my work, which bring them somewhere else and bring me also somewhere else. And on this particular project, I made also the scenography and the lighting.
Okay. If you're asked to create music to someone else's choreography, what's your, how do you begin your process?
I've done a lot of music for dance, and normally they, I don't know what, if they call me because they like my music or they like the kind of, sometimes they have already an instrument that they want because they hear it and they want this instrument for them.
Oh, so like they might like dance with the tube.
Yeah, yeah, that I've done what, I've done one in France where they saw me in concert and they wanted. So of course I changed the pieces and the length according to the choreography, but and this is also something that I try to make clear in the beginning that I'm not the kind that going back and forth. But if you ask me, it's because you believe in my creativity and my input,
mm-hmm.
and you have enough confidence to believe that when we mix things together, it's gonna work. So I can make proposition, but I don't go till the end composing a lot and like they cut half of it at the end. That I know. And I mean, one in my life when I was making a piece for Suzanne Birch, she was the choreographer at Royaume Abbey. She was there like for 15 or 17 years. And she was old, I was very young. And it was funny because she said, no, it's like cage. 10 days before the concert, we put things together, and so we traveled together. We talked about things, but never about the music. And my music was ready like 5 months before the creation, and she didn't want to hear it. And when I arrived with the proposition 10 days before the creation, she said, "Yeah, this is horrible. You have to put this out, And this is your ideas. You want to be like Cage and go to the end, and we just put things together." And
I'd be like Cage, then roll dice.
Yeah, but it was very strange moment. Also because I have the Royaume Abbey is a very special place for a composer, and I had the pressure of those people who hired me to make the music, and I didn't want to fight with them, but I didn't want also to respect what she wanted, because I worked 5 months on these pieces. You don't want to hear it, it's fine, but then I can change in 2 days. But so that's the only moment in my life where we agreed that on the 20 minutes that she wanted me to redo, that she cut 10 minutes, and that I do 10 minutes with material that I already had from other pieces.
Mm-hmm.
So I mix things that I had, because you can't make music in 2 days, or I can't make music in 2 days, something completely new just to please Madame or Monsieur. I like that. At the end, I'm happy with the result. So just because we talk about dance, I'm going to show you one that I really like. It's called My Body Will Never Stop to Dance. And it's for a dancer in metal plate, a sound installation called Seaquake, and amplified table. There's 6 huge metal plates and transducer under the table. Speakers fixed on the metal plate on each side. Also, there's one here that I play manually. And the piece is about the alienation of our life, especially for workers that do always the same gesture day after day, and they always take the same path to go to work and I have the same pattern. How it can be like very difficult for a human being.
Thank you.
also have a same kind of table in this corner where I respond to what she's doing, and she had an amplified table. I have also a small amplified table where I also do different kind of manipulation. I also play the big metal plates. So. Maybe just the boat piece? I don't know what time it is, but should be the score of the...
I have a quick question.
Yeah.
Were the larger metal walls, were those sort of the undertone or the drone? and then the percussive elements?
Was on the table.
Okay.
The thing, this installation is called Seaquake, and it's made to be presented outside, where there's normally more wind on the port or place like this. The installation is for, I can show you a photo. There's four metal plate in front, two big ones, and so it makes kind of a U. The music is sent to the big speakers. It's mostly frequency that are tuned with the frequency of the metal plate.
Yeah.
And they are sent just before the limit where they start to saturate and start to make distortion. So you have this quiet drum of frequency that glitz or so will shift. And then at one point when the wind goes inside the installation, didn't need a lot of energy to make a lot of disturbation, variation, make and also they play with the lights because they vibrate and physically they always move. At night you have all the lights of the city or the ports or whatever that are reflected, and you can see the vibration patterns. And so in this pieces, it's also, I asked her to make a project in this installation. So I use also this frequency as the main core of the pieces. And then I had a lot of things over it. Sirene, yeah. Sirene volante. So that one page of this core. So as you can see here, you have all the boat, and on the bottom the train. And it was 43 musicians that played that piece. There are three musicians by horn, one with the meter, the chronometer, one with the score, walkie-talkie, and the other one that manipulate the things. You have to realize if I find the photos. How big is the boat horn is quite a lot of glass. So you see how big it is? So they have like big earplugs and so there's normally one or two horn on each boat. And before my symphony, mostly people was using the siren as just the button, the rhythmical aspect of the siren. And I use it more as a French horn instrument when you put your hands or object in. How can you transform the sound, not adding only the horn, but also modulate the frequency, and so you're going to hear that, and I showed it. It's not this one. The excerpt is... I think the excerpt starts somewhere here. flows with future projects, because the future is always interesting. I'm going to show you the last installation that I made last year. Basically, it's it looks like this. There's 35 tube. And basically, the tube is kind of an overtone flute. There's the whistle, and it looks a bit like this. And I use a tube guard that protect the nail when they broke as the resonator. And I'm gonna show you a video how it sounds. Music, using a lot of staccato on this project, trying to create something different that I'm doing normally, which is more based on very long continuous evolution. And, it's also a reflection about sound installation. I realize with times that it's very difficult to get people evolved on the duration of the process. They always came for 5 minutes and they go. And music takes importance in time. It needs time to express itself. So you cannot just came and see and go and having the sense that you feel what it is. So in that project, I found that you can come for 2 minutes and go and you have a sense of what's happening. You cannot talk about the music, but you have a sense of what's happening. So the relation, that was 2 years ago. And the next project, if I get the money to make it, it's called The Cube. And let's finish this. So it's going to be 2,200 pipe tube, put it on a 2,200. two different cubes that are gonna make a bigger one, and basically I'm gonna be able to go walk inside where the sound is generated, or to go at the other extremity where the sound is delivered on the space, to have two different kind of contact with the sounds phenomenon. Also, so that's the view you can have if you're in the middle, if you're at the end. The lights is going to be also something quite important. I'm gonna put the LED, trichromic LED inside each white part of the instrument in order to add another layer of the installation, create different patterns, link it with the sound or not, sometimes link, sometimes not. And also I'm gonna work finally with mass of the same kind of instrument, which is gonna, we can bring music somewhere else, not a relation between two or five or ten instruments, but now being in front of a mass of sound from the same instrument. Yeah.
You said you haven't made this yet?
No, I produced all the drawing, conceptual and also technical development, and now I wait for the money to.
But this is all, this is Photoshop, what you have?
It's not, it's I don't know if it's AutoCAD or it's an architect program.
But it's, I'm saying like it's not a, like this situation doesn't exist yet.
Not yet, no.
Only
in my mind.
I was wondering if you could speak about when you're applying to, if it's the Conseil des Arts, whichever agencies you're applying for these grants, I guess how do you package your ideas in a way that a granting council can, they have an idea of what you want to make, and how, like, what advice would you give to composers who maybe aren't working in such a visual domain, but where the deliverable is just sound,
mm-hmm.
or is just is dance that doesn't exist yet, or something that you can't really see?
I think I realize with times, which is when you're in a jury, you have very little amount of time to judge a project. So you need to be as clear as possible, answer the question, make everything that in 2 minutes someone in front of your project like has very good ideas of what you're gonna do. You can say I'm gonna write a piece for saxophone, but then you can have also say, yeah, I'm gonna use multiphonic, and I'm gonna have four saxophones, and spread, and you can be like as clear as possible with your project, knowing that from the moment you write the application and the moment you finish the project, there's a lot of evolution.
Mm-hmm.
It might not look like this when I'm going to finish with the project. I think it's going to be quite close to that, but I might make change. It might be a circle, it might be, this is my idea now, and I work to try to define as much as possible this idea. But of course, when I'm gonna get the money and start to work with the materiality, I'm gonna have some problematic that I'm gonna have to resolve. I'm gonna find things also, especially when I'm gonna work on the music of the project. So at the end, the project is gonna be slightly different. Sometimes it's really different, sometimes it's just slightly different, but I think the council, they know about that, that you have a proposition, we give you the money, and then what you're gonna realize, it has to be related, of course. I don't say I'm gonna do this and then make a saxophone pieces, but I don't think they are stupid enough to tell me, but it's not really, you don't put red on your installation. And if I decide at one point that red is not anymore something that I want in the project. As long as you, yeah.
So first of all, we're gonna need to wrap it up and move to a reception. Most of the people here are going to have plenty of time to interact with you, to build with you, and to have like person-to-person conversation.
Yeah.
So I think we can continue in a reception. And just want to thank you for being here again with us. This is really a treat and very important for us all to see the long trajectory. So thank you.
Thanks for watching.